Boo.
Uncle Scooby? Hi, I'm Scrappy-Doo.
Scrappy Boo?
Let me at him!
Scooby, Scrappy-Dappy-Doo!
Ta-ta-ta-ta-ta! Puppy power!
Scrappy-Boo! Scooby-Dooby-Doo!
I don't understand. How did you know what was going on?
We had several clues, Mr. Sloan. Because of the crimes, whoever was pretending to be the Blue Scarab had to have read the unpublished comic.
Then the Blue Scarab is my publisher, Mr. Hardy.
Well, no. You see, whoever it was also a good artist, as we could tell by the quality of the scarab he painted on the wall.
Of course! It's my rival, Floyd Hotchkiss.
No, it's not him either.
It's not?
Nope. Our last clue was the Scarab's disappearance in the hallway. He didn't run out past us, and the only other person in the hall was...
my assistant, Gruber? I don't believe it.
I don't either.
But, officer, why is Scotland Yard interested in these Wonder World fakes?
Those aren't fakes, Shaggy. Those are the real crown jewels.
What?
I'll take these. Velma's right. They're the real thing.
The clue was that picture of the Tower of London Shaggy's fish and chips were wrapped in. The article describes the same crime, but there's a TV antenna in the picture. Since there isn't one at the London World Tower, it had to be the real Tower of London.
Then the article describes not Velma's fantasy mystery, but a real crime.
Criminal hid the jewels where no one would think to look, in plain sight at Wonderworld.
But when the computer came up with Velma's fantasy, his plans went down the drain.
Right. The robot Night Ghoul malfunctioned, stole the real jewels, and hid them.
So the criminal disguised as the Night Ghoul tried to scare us off and find them himself.
Remember, no one was supposed to know what mystery the computer picked. Mr. Marino.
I don't believe it.
I don't understand how you kids figured it out.
It was easy, officer. Our first clue was the glowing handprints in the car, which indicated someone was using phosphorescent paint to give himself an alien look.
Paint which rubbed off on the steering wheel.
That's great. What next?
The hot engine on the crane in the abandoned construction area told us it wasn't abandoned.
The alien hid the saucer under one of the cement pads and lifted it with the crane.
You mean Planet X was just under a cement pad? Huh? I knew it all the time.
This space weapon is actually a remote control device used to operate the saucer from the ground, operated by Tessie.
This black box contains batteries and a dimmer. That's how he was able to increase or decrease his glow.
But this electrical supply circular we found on Steve Shimmer's desk was the big clue. It advertises this black box, the dimmer, and the timer he used at the Chinese theater.
Like Scuba and I knew all the time it was Steve Shimmer, huh?
Yeah, sure.
You caught him.
That's terrific.
Huh?
Then who's the Phantom?
This was delivered to Steve by mistake. Look at it.
Yuma Pun's eel?
Look at it this way.
7:33 sundown?
That's where it was supposed to be delivered, right next door to Sparkles.
Which is 7:31 sundown.
That's right. It's Mr. Walker.
It was simple. You see, when we first returned from the bazaar, I noticed our ship was riding lower in the water. There was no red hull visible,
like there is now.
That meant something heavy had been loaded on board in Haiti.
But when we checked the cargo hold in Miami, it was empty.
So there had to be a secret cargo compartment somewhere on the ship.
Right. And here in New Orleans, the boat was riding high in the water again. So the cargo must have been unloaded on the dock while we were sleeping.
These purple flowers showed one of the floats had pulled up to the boat. The cargo had to be on the purple float.
Mike, what about the snake demon?
The crook was just taking advantage of the snake demon legend to scare people off the boat in Miami.
So the silver could be unloaded.
Right. But on the dock in Haiti, Shaggy found the only key to the secret compartment. The snake demon couldn't unload the cargo.
Then the demon wasn't after me. He needed my key.
And he got it in time to unload the silver in New Orleans. Didn't you, First Mate Defarge?
Right now we're flying without anything. Hang on!
We did it! A perfect three-point landing.
Well, 3 points out of 100 isn't bad.
Sky skeleton. But what was he after?
I had my suspicions after Shaggy and Scooby discovered that goop in the well water.
You mean the same stuff that was in the mine tunnel?
That's when I realized this map is a geological survey of the area. It shows the location of oil under the airfield, and it's stamped confidential because it hasn't been made public yet.
And it doesn't belong to Mr. Ed Depp.
Then whose is it?
It belongs to the editorial department of Newsbreak magazine.
Eddie Drake?
You have caught the dragon beast. But, like, who is it?
It's simple. When you put all the clues together, he made his special appearances through the secret tunnel under the pitcher's mound.
And used fireworks to create the dragon in the sky and the smoke screen.
The dragon in the smoke was projected from the bright lights on the scoreboard, lit up in a dragon shape.
But the clincher was the boxes of fireworks in that warehouse.
We found these same metal bands in the tunnel.
And realized the crates weren't going to the USA. They were from...
Husai?
Right, Mr. Husai. It looks like this case is already wrapped up.
Right in a bear rug.
So the cliff dwellings aren't haunted after all.
There was never really a devil bear to begin
with.
Our
first clue was the 5 claw marks on the painting. A real bear would only leave 4.
And the paint on Shaggy's shirt proved that at least some of the cave paintings were fresh.
So someone was making new paintings to lead you in the wrong direction.
Someone who knew enough about Indian art to fool even archaeologists.
You mean Ranger Brantley?
No, your assistant. Chuck Hunt.
It's okay, Keith. Now we've got him.
But who is it?
Well, who?
It's easy to figure out once you know what's been going on.
Well, that leaves us out.
When you found the pearl necklace in the abalone, Shaggy, that confirmed my suspicions about the sunken galleon in the bay.
When we found there was no treasure on board, we realized the current that had pulled us into the cove...
had pulled the treasure there, too.
Where they were gobbled up by the abalone. Like, I get it.
So the sea beast was only a disguise to keep people away while the treasures were stolen.
And he had to make an appearance in the cove to keep the cliff divers from discovering the treasures.
But who is it anyway?
It's Tiger Morris.
So did I.
Yikes! Daphne!
I'm glad you're all here because one of you is the vampire.
Well, you're kidding.
And also a crook. Responsible for the theft of the giant diamond, emerald, and ruby originally stolen by Lefty Callahan.
The ruby was hidden in the boat light, the emerald in the tiger's eye.
And the diamond in the chandelier, right, Fred?
But who's the vampire?
I figured that out when I saw the opera was closed tonight. Mrs. Cornell couldn't go to Fisherman's Wharf because she was coming to the opera, which she did, as the vampire.
Relax, Scoob. She's not really a vampire.
Of course, it isn't really a star creature. When I noticed the telescope kept being reset to point toward the city, I realized something was up.
Then this strobe light we found told us the creature was a phony, using equipment from the laser light show to create his star creature outfit.
But, like, what was he after?
The guard at Star Laboratories told us there had been no break-ins. But that secrets were getting out.
And everything clicked into place. The telescope was pointing right at the windows of Star Labs.
Like, that's how the secrets were getting out.
So who is this character?
The only person who had free access to both the telescope and the laser show. Mr. Greenfield himself.
But with all those monsters from the Batty Awards loose in the house, who is it?
That's easy to figure out once you know what's really been going on here tonight. The first clue was the newspaper story about the priceless first day covers.
Right. They're not blankets at all, but a special and very valuable kind of stamp.
You mean like the ones I found in that old book?
I mean exactly the ones you found.
Then the shadow creature wasn't trying to break up the Batty Awards. He was after the stamps.
Wrong. He already had the stamps. He was after the film.
But why?
Because one of its scenes accidentally showed the thief leaving the stamp shop after the robbery. Brandon Davies impersonated the shadow creature so it would be blamed when he destroyed the film.
Is everyone all right?
Like everyone but the ghost. But he'll thaw out by spring.
He was after the lost wagon of Jeremiah Pratt all along.
Right. And the ghostly rumblings we heard were the explosives he was using to find it.
But what was he after?
What we read about in Pratt's journal. A wagon of eagles.
Eagles?
Oh, come on. What would he want with a bunch of birds?
Back in those days, Scrappy, $10 gold pieces were called eagles. That's what he was after.
And unless we miss our guess, the WHP monogram on Will Henry Skies stands for Will Henry Pratt.
I've got it. Thank you.
Well, it looks like we've locked up this case.
Thanks to my Uncle Scooby.
Nice work, kids. But where did you find another black pearl?
The same place Haldane's ghost did, on the boardwalk, at the glassblower's booth.
Our clue was the gray powder in the bottom of the box.
Right. It wasn't dust at all, but tiny fragments of glass.
Glass?
We realized that the real pearl had been replaced by a glass copy.
And only one person could have made the switch. Morgan the magician.
You see, the Minotaur was after the art treasures hidden during the war and never recovered.
But how did you know?
Our first clue was the pieces of these beautiful old picture frames we found in Petro's campfire.
The villain found the paintings in the labyrinth beneath the ruins.
And used the Minotaur legend to keep people off the streets while he dragged the sacks of loot into the shed behind the taverna.
The heavy sacks made skid marks that we found on the labyrinth ramp.
We realized then that not all the art treasures were paintings.
Thank you.
Zoinks!
The treasure consisted of priceless stone statues as well.
I get it. The loot was hidden in the crates of olives bound for Silver Tree's boat.
Right. We realized that when we found the piece of canvas and olive in the shed.
The loot was headed for England, where it would be sold on the black market by Nick Pappas.
Push harder, Scooby. This is going to be our only chance after all. Zoinks! No!
I told you he'd think of something. Over here, Uncle Scooby.
I don't believe it.
Hold on, Scoob!
I am, I am.
Hooray for Uncle Scooby!
Boy. Oh, you're terrific.
Thanks a lot, guys. Isn't he wonderful? The best uncle a guy ever had.
Yeah, a real he-dog.
Okay, we give up.
Just think of someplace quiet, like a nice jail cell.
Boy, we splatted them good this time, didn't we?
Yeah.
Splatting takes a lot out of him.
Huh?
Uncle Scooby.
Hi,
I'm Scrappy-Doo.
Scrappy-Doo?
Let me at him!
Scooby, Scrappy-Dappy-Doo, Scooby. Uncle Scooby, Scrappy-Dappy-Doo!
Scooby-Dooby-Doo!